Did defendant Bryan Kohberger actually attend a memorial for the four slain students? Did the killer brag in online chat rooms? Where is the murder weapon? And why did one roommate who survived wait over 7 hours to call 911? And how will a wily defense attorney try and break the state's case? Good evening. I'm Nancy Grace. Thank you for being with us for this special report on the Idaho student murders. Right now, more questions than answers. And tonight, we will be taking your questions. Did defendant Bryan Kohberger actually attend a memorial for the four slain students? With me, an all-star panel to make sense of what we know right now. But joining me, Dr. Bethany Marshall, psychoanalyst, joining us out of Beverly Hills at drbethanymarshall.com. Dr. Bethany, if this is true, and defendant Bryan Kohberger actually attended the memorial for the four slain students, what would that tell you? I mean, it wouldn't be the first time we have seen a murder defendant show up at funerals. Normally, and in this case as well, detectives are combing the funeral or the memorial just so they can spot the defendant.
Nancy, this doesn't surprise me at all. We see this all the time, you know, with cases of domestic homicide that we've covered where the wife is dead and the husband goes to the memorial, is passing out flyers. See, Nancy, I think he's still glorying. He's still reveling in the crime, and he's self-glorifying the crime. You know, think about this. He's been fascinated with crime his entire life. His undergraduate degree was in crime. He's getting a PhD in criminology. He distributed that questionnaire on Reddit and on Facebook, asking people if they've ever committed a crime, what they felt during, before, and after the commission of the crime. This is a man who is fascinated with crime. And the fact that he stalked the victims prior to the crime tells me that the offending cycle began long before he murdered those four students, and then it continued after the commission of the crime. So we think of the crime
well, this is just happening on that night, Dr. Bethany,
self-glorifying fantasies and the gratification
and
he got from the crime
McCollum
extended over many, many weeks on until that memorial service.
Another issue that is emerging is there's been a lot of backlash against one of the two girls that survived, DM, as she is named in the probable cause affidavit, because she waited over 7 hours to raise a bell of alarm and get 911 called. There may be a lot of factors for that.
Hey, Nancy, if I could interject about that for a point.
Yeah, jump in, doctor.
There are very strong biological underpinnings to why she reacted the way she did. She had what's called fight or flight. Fight or flight, it's kind of sometimes called flight or freezing, is that when a person is faced with a threat, they will either fight or they will freeze in some way. Freezing is a very common response, and that's what she did. And we don't know if she was used to other students coming in and out. It was also four in the morning. We don't know if they'd been drinking or if she was super tired, waking up out of a sleep, but certainly she was terrified, and when people are terrified, Nancy, they can dissociate, they can freeze, and sleeping is very strongly correlated with the freezing response.
You have the stark dichotomy of what appears to be very premeditated moves on the part of the alleged killer, Bryan Kohberger. And this is what I'm talking about. Out of all the many, many times he's been coming over and casing that home, the murder home where the victims lived in the early morning hours when it's still dark, late at night, 12 times that we know of, all the way back to June. But this night, this one night of all nights, he cuts his cell phone off or puts it in airplane mode as he's driving from Moscow, driving from WSU to Moscow. and then en route back home, he flips it back on. That is cold, John.
Nancy, if I could interject, I do not think this is just surveillance. I think that many serial killers, and I do believe Bryan Kohberger was, this was the first of what he intended to be, a series of killings. They just, he could happen to get caught the first time around. But there is a very strong sexual component to serial killing. Serial killers and psychopaths use the infliction of pain and harm in order to enhance their sexual arousal. So we may talk about him surveilling or casing the joint or trying to get ready for the crime, but I also think this was a part of a masturbatory fantasy. Serial killers are voyeuristic. I think he was like a peeping Tom. So we need to think of this entire crime as spanning when he began to, you use the word surveil or stalk, but he began to fuel his sexual fantasies by watching these young women.
But let me go to Dr. Bethany Marshall. Everyone wants to know about a motive. Give it to me in a nutshell, Dr. Bethany. Possible motive.
Sociopaths have something called autonomic underarousal. That means that they don't experience anxiety, pleasure, heightened emotions like the rest of us. Because they have such low levels of emotional arousal, they cannot feel sexual excitement like normal people do either. So they maim, they kill, they inflict cruelty on others in order to achieve a sexual high. That's why I believe this was a sexually motivated crime. It's interesting that DM heard the killer say, "It's okay, I'm here to help you." That means that the killer not only had a sadistic sexual orientation, but also some kind of a God fantasy, just like the BTK killer. Remember when he represented himself in court? He bragged to the jury and the judge that he comforted one of his victims before he strangled her. So the motivation is to feel all powerful over another human being.
Bottom line, I do not think the two roommates that survived were, quote, in on the killings. That's a common theme in the questions. Guys, I want to thank you for joining us tonight. There's so much more evidence to go through. Crime Stories is heading to Idaho to bring you the latest. Thank you to all of our guests, but especially to you for being with us. Nancy Grace, signing off.